There's a heartbeat louder than thunder. Revolution is in the air.
Heartbeat Alaska is brought to you by Coca-Cola, serving Alaskans quality soft drinks since 1937. By Cook Inlet Region Incorporated, an Alaska Native corporation promoting economic and social progress for people throughout the state.
And by the Alaska Seafood Marketing Institute, educating consumers and promoting sales of Alaska seafood throughout the U.S. and in international markets.
To Heartbeat Alaska Native News and Native Entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green. So glad to have you with us. And a special hello to some viewers in Antioch, California. They watch Heartbeat Alaska from KCSM in San Mateo. The names are Paul Royer and Corinne Royer. And they're more than just viewers. They contributed video this week. A powwow held in Berkeley, California. So glad to have you with us. And we're glad to have viewers in Sitka, Alaska back again. Broadcast from KTNL in Sitka and also KNEB-TV in Ketchikan. Thank you so much for joining us for Heartbeat Alaska. Besides Berkeley, California, we'll be traveling to Selawik, Alaska, as well as to Craig and to Bethel, all that plus much more. But first, here's Gary Fife with Native News Across the Nation.
This is Native News Across the Nation. I'm Gary Fife. In its last convention, the Alaska Federation of Natives membership adopted a resolution endorsing oil development and exploration in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. That endorsement came over opposition from Gwich'in Athabascans who want to protect caribou herds. Assistant Secretary for Indian Affairs Ada Deer has expressed her opposition to the development of ANWR, and she's pushed that position in the administration and on Capitol Hill. Congress has now given its approval to the measure, and it remains for President Clinton to make good his promise to veto the budget bill that contains the ANWR provision. The Anchorage Daily News reported that the Arctic Slope Regional Corporation could get the jump on other oil developers. It's poised to begin operations if such an ANWR provision is passed into law. Thousands of Canadians have been expressing their feelings about the proposed secession of the province of Quebec from the nation of Canada. If the French-speaking province decides to leave Canada, some natives who live within its borders have vowed to leave that new nation, fearing a takeover by the Quebec government. There have been several conflicts between natives, such as the Mohawks, with local Quebec security forces in places such as Oka, where an armed standoff occurred over a land dispute. The possibilities of massive cuts to the Bureau of Indian Affairs has tribes across the nation worried. Many of them, including the Bureau of Indian Affairs itself, are considering major reductions in staff and programming in anticipation of those federal cuts. One of them, the Muscogee Creek Nation of Oklahoma, has already declared a state of tribal emergency. The Creeks are worried, along with other tribal governments, they'll lose out in areas such as labor, education, housing, plus health and human services. Creek Principal Chief Bill Fife vowed to continue their lobbying effort to fight planned reductions, educate Congress on Native issues, guard against termination, and fight for restoration of those budget cuts. This past week in Southeast Alaska, a new totem has been raised, but it's not just another piece of wonderful art. It's a new totem carved in memory of a Native youth who died of a drug overdose, and it's dedicated to fighting substance abuse among Native American youth. Carver Stan Marsden completed the work to remember his son Jimmy. It's the first traditional pole raising in the town of Craig, Alaska's history, and Jeannie will have more on that story later in the program. And finally, with the phenomenal growth of Native participation in the music industry, such as what you see here in Heart of Bead, Alaska, it's been a real challenge to keep up with Native artists and musical styles, or to keep track of traditional artists and their work for that matter. But a new directory of that material may be what you're looking for. It's called A Guide to Native American Music Recordings by author Greg Gombert. The directory has over 1,300 entries of recordings, record companies, and distributors of Native American music of every style. The guide is available from Multicultural Publishing in Fort Collins, Colorado. And we'd like to take a second to issue a warm congratulations and welcome a special hello to our new affiliates, the Haskell Indian Nations University in Lawrence, Kansas. And if you have information about your group or tribe, please share it with us here. Put us on your mailing list. This is Native News Across the Nation. For Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Gary Fife.
From a Native perspective. Heartbeat Alaska is the Native news source for America. We welcome you to be a reporter. Call us today and we'll train you. Join the team.
Hello, welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native news and Native entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green.
This is Native News Across the Nation. I'm Gary Fife.
Hello, Heartbeat Alaska from way down south, Window Rock, Arizona.
For Heartbeat Alaska and SKC Public TV, this is Annette Brown.
For Heartbeat, I'm Eve Little in Taos, New Mexico. There's a heartbeat, loud as thunder. There's a
heartbeat, coming up from deep down under. As Gary Fife mentioned earlier, there's been a special totem pole raising in Craig, Alaska. Ken Yates was there during the carving, and carver Stan Marsden says, the totem pole carving began with the heartache, but ended with the healing.
It's called the Healing Heart Totem. What started in Craig, Alaska as one man's memorial to his son has turned into a community project to keep kids drug-free. Tsimshian native and master carver Stan Marsden reported each day to carve a totem pole in honor of his son Jimmy, who died of a cocaine overdose in 1991. Marsden named the totem the Healing Heart.
And it was really hard for me to take. I had to stay home. Then I'd go down to the bar because I like to dance. You know? I don't drink, I don't smoke. I just go down there to play for me. And I had this pain in my heart, a real ache, and feel like an open wound, feel like a knife cut. It really hurt. Right, I was sitting at the bar. One woman from Selawik came over and said, "Stan, you better accept what has happened. Accept it. If you don't accept it, it's not gonna be good." When she said that, she put her hand on my shoulder, and the pain went away. And that happened again several days later. I was down at the bar again, and the pain was there. Come back. Every once in a while it comes back real strong. And another friend came up and said, "Stan, come dance with me." And just as soon as she touched my arm, the pain went away.
Stan Marsden does not drink or smoke. And though he went to a bar to dance, he realized it was not the bar that helped promote his healing. Rather, it was the touch of his fellow human being. And he says he hopes the pole will help people feel the love they have for one another.
And I started thinking about that. These are all different people, people I didn't even know. Different tribe Indians, white people. And I started thinking about it, how much that we have to depend on each other. Even people we don't know. People who care what's going on. It's surprising how their feelings will help you.
It didn't take long for the project to catch on. Members of the community of Craig volunteered, offered help with the carving. They also came from Klawak and Metlakatla and Heidelberg.
We've done rummage sales and just asked for donations for the celebration. And people have been really responsive in every area, food, money, just whatever. It's been really neat to see how everybody's been pulling together from different walks of life for the same good cause. So it's been pretty neat. And I want to thank Stan for taking on this project, because it's kind of for all of us, and it has a lot to me, means a lot to me personally, and I just thank him for doing it. It's great.
Stan Marsden is a well-known carver on Prince of Wales Island and throughout Southeast Alaska. He carved the totem pole, which stands on Main Street in Ketchikan, and he's carved several totems, some of them now in other countries. He started teaching Native art and carving to others about 30 years ago. He's lectured in Fairbanks and Washington and California. The Healing Heart Totem is his largest ever, 46 and a half feet long. He designed the pole, incorporating the traditional family clan symbols. At the top is a killer whale, Marsden's clan, followed by a raven, his father's clan. Next is a man, and then a frog. The pole is made of red cedar, taken from the island and donated by the Sea Alaska Corporation. It took Marsden a month to clear the bark from the pole. The final figure on the pole is the bear, one of the main clan figures of the Tsimshians. Marsden is originally from the Tsimshian community of Metlakatla. Perhaps one of the most interesting features of this pole are the roses. Marsden said they represent all that's good.
And a friend of mine came down and brought some roses down and had them sitting right on where the roses are now before we even thought of it. And weeks after the roses died, you know, and then I finally thought of using this here as a symbol. The rose is a symbol of love, peace, and beauty. around the world. It's a universal flower, meaning the same thing all over. Everybody's love put into the pole, everybody cares, all the free labor, and everybody know why we're here. When we come down here, it's only a ritual that we have to put our shed together before we go to work. Every day we have to do that. But we're winning all the time.
Right on, right on.
And I hope that this carries on as what we're trying to do.
Thank you once again, Ken Yates, for that video from Craig, Alaska. Let's travel now to Bethel, Alaska, where the youngsters there celebrated Alaska Day, Day, Day. They marched 250 kindergartners, pre-first graders, and first graders from McGillingut Illitnarvit School in Bethel, Alaska. According to teacher Paul Sugar, it's an annual event. The Alaska Day March ends 3 weeks of studies of Alaska Native people. Alaska Day is usually meant to celebrate when Russia handed over Alaska to America. But Paul Sugar likes to think it's a study of the people, a celebration of the people of Alaska, all tribes, all nations.
There is a state away up north, Alaska is its name, oh, A-L-A-S-K-A, 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 Alaska is its name.
A-L-A-S-K-A is its name-o. Thank you, Paul Sugar, for the video from Bethel, Alaska. And thank you, everyone who contributed to that story, everyone that took the video as well. From Alaska Day, now we celebrate Inupiaq Day, this time in Selawik, Alaska.
The village of Selawik, Alaska is found at the confluence of two channels of the Selawik River and near Selawik Lake, 70 miles southeast of Kotzebue. The village was established in 1909. Prior to that date, Selawik, or Nilik as it was called, was located 30 miles further up the Selawik River. That site is now abandoned. Selawik has a population of around 640 people. There are no roads to Selawik and no roads in Selawik due to the marsh tundra. To get around, boardwalks are used by both people and four-wheelers. There are four stores in Selawik. The town covers an area of about 1 mile. It's an Inupiaq village. Some say the name Selawik is derived from the Inupiaq word meaning place of she-fish.
One quick way you could identify Summit Rock from another plant is that the bottom of these plants, the leaves are always white. And right now they're real brown, like as you can see, Ubani. What we did was we just picked the leaves and then put in some water and boiled it. Grab one of these, by the way. I'll tell you guys a similar story of my own.
Inupiaq Day was held on September 29th, a day dedicated to teaching Inupiaq tradition to the students.
About 30 years ago, my dad was sent to Anchorage because he had a real bad stomach. So they operated him, Mona and Umunga. They opened his stomach, took most of it out, and then closed it back. But then after they did that, the doctors realized that it was too late. So he was still deteriorating, getting worse day by day. What they did was his doctor was Dr. Nielsen. He's a real tall, old doctor. Anyway, they sent him home to die because in spite of all the technology and all the medicine they had there, they couldn't help him. And so anyway, they sent him home to die. And I remember when that first day he came home, he was so weak he couldn't even talk. And then my Anna, my dad's mom, Amena, went there and it knocked to his head. And Agayok Borak, and I remember that was the first time I actually hear somebody really pray loud. I mean, it was like she was so good. I mean, to me at that time, because I was small, I thought she was so good talking to my pop. And me loving my pop so much, I started crying because I thought, you know, she was holding my dad. Anyway, after she prayed, she went up. She told my mom to go out there and pick as much southern rocks that she could find. She went out there, picked a whole bunch, and my aunt showed her how to make this southern rock juice. You want some? So anyway, my dad, they sent him home to Tupu. My aunt, my mom started making jars and jars of this. I remember our house, the edge of the house used to have big jars of this stuff. About maybe 50 jars of sugarcane rock, and my mom started letting my pop have sugarcane rock in the morning, in the afternoon, and in the evening. Three times a day. I mean, she would have like big, he would drink big jar, and all he had for one whole year was just sugarcane rock and jello. Lunchtime he would have a little bit jello. But all he had, because his stomach was so messed up, he couldn't handle any solid foods. So after a while, my dad started getting better. That was 30 years ago. Here they send him home to die.
Before contact with the Western world, the native people of Alaska depended upon their own traditional medicines, medicines from what Mother Nature provided. Inupiaq Day in Selawik, Alaska, emphasized Native tradition, Inupiaq tradition. Ruby and Elsie Foster taught the students how to make a fish net and how to repair the net.
You don't have to pick the auger, you've got to learn. First we'll work on those, you first graduate, first plan to make for your kids.
Under the watchful eye of Marge Tikett, the students also learn beaver tanning. Perhaps the most important lesson here is to listen to your elders. With a teacher like Marge Tikett, that's easy to do. You can't just watch, you must jump in and do it the Inupiaq way.
Okay, you don't want to?
Yeah, see
ya. Yeah, like that. You should bite it. Bite it. Your brother did bite it.
Thank you.
you so much for joining me for more Native news and entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green. Hello once again to students in Haskell Indian Nations University. We're so happy to have you with us. Also, hello Sitka Ketchikan. Hello California and all across the U.S. and especially to our viewers in Florida and Montana. We're looking forward to video from your area. As always, I'm Jeannie Green, wishing you the best this week. Be safe, be careful, God bless, and we'll see you again next week.
As lovers were smoldering sweet grass, stopped only to kiss you and Don, through the smoke rising upwards I saw your face. Nobody knows where we're going. We ain't made any wrong turns yet. When the darkness falls I will hold you to my chest. Smiled when we parted and cried when we tomorrow, but love me tonight. No need to cling to your heart. No need to say it.